My name is Attila Korab. I work for Monotype, not Adobe, as it says in the program. And I think Bram is actually working for Adobe in a way. And I'm here to talk about one part of Monotype that I think not everybody really knows about. The motto of the company is typefaces, technology, and expertise. But then when you ask what is technology, and people would think, I don't know, maybe font tools or font development tools or anything that has to do with fonts. Of course, it has to do with fonts. It's not font development. It's not services for the web or so. It's a technology that we actually sell or license to people who build devices, who build operating systems, and they include the technology in their product, basically. The technologies, is this for me? Well, okay. The names of those technologies is iType and Whittle. If you go to the Monotype website, you will find a lot of information about all the technologies that we have. But basically, it's two software components. One is iType, the other one is Whittle, and they have a lot of features that are distributed as products, basically, or that are presented as products, which is not really the case. It's a bit confusing, I know, but we're working on getting the information to the people properly. Both those software modules are software development kits written in C and C++, and they've been ported to a dozen platforms. So it means you get a package of source code and pre-compiled binary data that you can load into your own application and then make use of what these libraries deliver. And they do quite a lot of things. We've ported those probably to Android, Symbian OS, iOS. We can make them work on hardware directly, so without any OS, you have like a white goods or so where you can really put the software on the chip and it runs on the chip without an operating system. We've done that too. Let's first talk about the Whittle. Whittle is short for World Type Layout Engine. It does a number of things that you are actually familiar with in other applications. For instance, it does the shaping for OpenType and AAT. Like here in this case, Avantgarde, who was it who doesn't know what OpenType features are? No, so you know what it is. And AAT is a format by Apple. They have a similar technique to do substitutions or to place glyphs on a canvas, and we have implemented both shaping technologies in Whittle. It can do bidi text or bidirectional text, and it can do Unicode. It supports Unicode in its latest version. What I mean by bidi is when you type Arabic, you go from right to left, and then when you type a number, you write it from left to right, and the software takes care of that and makes sure that your cursor is pointing to the right direction, that it don't get confused, and you know always where you're at while you're typing. It can be very confusing. It has some fixed substitutions, like this colon and what is it, a brace, and then you get the smiley, and it has a lot. It has a dictionary that you can edit. The client can go in and put icons in their font, and then they make these fixed substitutions, so they don't need to use the shaper, basically. It gives the application that uses Whittle the option to do effects on the type. You can do glowing, background color changing, or the type color, or emboldening, like the style linking is working in there. So it knows a lot of. It gives an API to the programmers to make use of of fonts, basically. But it's not everything it does. It's not. This is more like the font-related stuff. And Whittle actually does a bit more. It actually delivers an API for text layout. It knows layout modes. Layout is actually, I'm going to talk about now, the different modes. And the application uses the logic in Whittle to display text. The most basic way is string-based. So what you do is you ask Whittle, here's a string. Now give me the representation of the string back. And what Whittle does, it can do that. And you can give it more information, like, I just want to have 64 characters long. This because I want to name an icon or whatever. And then it does a truncation. It does this ellipsis truncation at the end or in the middle of the text phrase, all that automatically. Then you can ask it to render text for you line by line. So it does all the open type and all the styling of the font for you, but line by line. So you're responsible for the line height, for instance, and you feed it with a few parameters to get what you want. This is a more comfortable way of setting or laying out text. It's a block-based layout mode. And what you do here is you just give it a text and say, give me a box this size and lay out the text in this point size with this styles, and then you get back what it does. And it does the hyphenation, it does truncation if you want to, yeah, and all the open type features as well, which you can switch on and off for this text block. And the most complex version of laying out text is the container-based, where you have text that flows from one box to another. You know that from InDesign, of course. Excuse me. Yeah, and that's actually a good example that explains what a layout engine does. It does exactly that, like laying out text, and you can build on that and create your own application, whatever it is. In Whittle, there's another tool. It's iType. An iType is a rendering engine. A rendering engine does the following. It reads the font, gets the outline data out of the font. It opens up a raster or a grid, and then it scales the outline to fit in that grid. And then it adjusts the outline by processing hints. And then it decides which pixel to turn on and which stays off. And then it generates the bitmap and gives it back to the application that is asking for a glyph. And one of the applications that is doing that is actually Whittle. It can do quadratic or cubic outlines, so it can render OpenType CFFs, OpenType TrueTypes. It can it understands TrueType collections, CFR, which is a format that can link many different fonts together, so that you don't have to rebuild a font all the time. Like every time you add a language, you don't have to make a big font. You can have like many little fonts that have support for different languages. It has a real-time order hinter, so it really is so it has some intelligence to optimize the output. It does all the special effects like glowing and drop shadow and embossing and I don't know what. Stuff you don't want to use probably as a designer. It has a number of compression techniques for CJK fonts because, as I said, we're licensing this software to people who make devices like mobile phones or cars, car displays. And they have memory constraints. There's still a lack of memory and still a lack of CPU power. And it's very important for them to keep the file size of fonts very small. And CJK fonts, they can easily be 20 megabytes or so. With the compression technologies, we're able to compress them down to 4 megabytes, 5 megabytes. So sounds very boring, I know. Anyway, the most interesting part of iType is Edge, Edge and CMS, CSM. This is also a rendering technique. It's kind of a side chain to the rendering engine in iType. And to understand what I'm talking about, let's see at the classical grayscaling. What you do in classical grayscaling is like you take a pixel, a big pixel, and then you divide it into, let's say, 100 pixels. Then you count how many of those pixels would be inside the outline, how many are outside the outline, and that way you can decide it's 70% gray, and that's how you paint the pixel. So this is one way to do it. Or the other way is you divide the pixel in segments that approach the outline, and then you measure the area and decide how gray the pixel is going to be. Edge is doing it differently. It has it uses adaptive distance fields. It's a technology that was developed by Mitsubishi, I think. We licensed it. And what the principle or the basic idea is, if you have an outline, the red curve there, you decide on a spot inside the outline that you define as black, and you decide on a spot outside the outline where you say this is white, and in between you make the gray gradient, and this is how you have a different. Yeah, you can have a much longer gray gradient going from black to white, because those points are actually dynamic. You can either move them towards each other, which makes the gradient steeper. Is this clear to everyone? This is looking at an outline, and the gradient on the edge of the curve. And by moving the cutoffs, we call them cutoffs, towards each other, I make the gradient steeper, and so it becomes sharper. The edge of my character is getting very, very sharp. By pulling them apart, I make the edge softer, and I have a much softer display of the glyph. I will show you the tool after the presentation, basically. If I move them both in the same direction, I can make the stroke thicker or thinner, which is also very interesting for people who want to have a fake bold. It actually looks a bit better than adding just one pixel on each side, because I can be a bit more precise. So this process is called continuous stroke modulation, and you can adjust your typeface for every display. Basically, what you can do is take a font and then have optimize it for a different scenario, for ebooks, for ebook readers, I mean, or in a car where you have 3-4 different displays and they're in different places where you have different lighting conditions. So like the ambient light in the lower end of your console is much darker than the display in front of you. So you can use the edge technology to display the one that's in the light a bit stronger, to make it a bit bolder, and that way you can read it easier. And we have complete control about the edge tuning, actually. I can do it separately for glyph groups, which would be languages, for instance. I can do it separately for different sizes, because some sizes are worse than others, and I can do it for every background and foreground color as well. Here's a sample of font tuning implemented into a Kobo book, Kobo ebook reader. This is actually, the end user can specify how he wants the typeface to be tuned so that his reading, so that he can match it to the way he's used to read. Sorry. Let me go to Windows and show you the tool. Yeah, and here's a somewhat old demo that shows you the use in a car tool, and you have the slider here. Oh no, come on. So, doesn't work. Sorry? No, that's actually not possible. The way we do it is we go to the clients, well, except for COBOL, and we take their displays, we install the font without the edge tuning, then we tune it on a PC with this tool. Let me see if I have a waterfall. Yeah. And then you go in and you say, okay, I want to make this softer. And then you see what happens in this area. It gets much blurrier. Of course, you would never use these extreme values. It's just as far as we can go. If you make it sharper, there's a limit, because when the ramp, the gray value, when it's 90 degrees, there's no point beyond that. Then it's just black and white. But it doesn't move. So as you
should have zoomed in one.
So I think I should do this right. Sorry? You meant that, no?
Yeah.
I zoomed in the wrong. Yeah. So now you see it in the zoom as well. You have very subtle influence on what it looks like. You see, the thinner has a contrary effect to the making it softer. Just kind of have to find the sweet spot where it works for the display. And the differences, I mean, you know it from presenting everyone, when you have different beamers and they display your presentation differently. And well, it's the same with cars or medical devices or white goods or whatever. So I hurried up a bit to catch up. I hope it was interesting. Are there
Thank
any
you.
Questions?
Any questions?
Thanks.